remember getting off the bus at the top of the hill there up on Hamsley and walking down what they call Allen's Bank to come and look at the house that we were going to get. It was a pit house because my dad was working in the colliery here and had been travelling up from Gateshead to work, so it was quite good that we were going to move here. Yeah, and there were six colliery houses in the street in Fife Terrace belonged to the pit, and they housed the pit workers. So it was number 6 to number 11, and we lived in number 6. There was no baths at the pit. They would come home dirty on a night time and have to get bathed in front of the fire.
My name's John Scott. I was born in this street 88 years ago, next month, on the left-hand side, number 6. Well, by today's standards, we were poverty-stricken. But we didn't think so. We thought we were well off, we were very happy. As my father insisted, we had clean beds, dry feet and full bellies, and that was the outlook then. You know, in our house, we didn't even have a radio until about 1942. And then it was a homemade one. My father used to listen to the news at a neighbour's house because they had a radio, the war news.
Well, my dad was the only worker in the family. And I mean, there was my mum, and then there was 6 of us all together, 4 brothers and 2 sisters. So it was mainly just the one wage coming into the household. So every penny counted. Every penny counted, you know what I mean? And if you didn't eat everything, you did without, or you got it the next meal type of thing.
Yeah, I mean, we only had one cold tap. I mean, that was the plumbing in the house, you know, and the outside loo. But we had the old range, the fire with the pot at the side of the fireplace where you heated the water, mm-hmm. and you ladled it out into the bath.
Waiting in the steps and sitting on the windowsills, which now would be obviously health and safety would go through the window, you know, but they used to go outside upstairs and sit on the windowsills and turn round and wash the windows, sitting on the windowsills and lean back from the outside. But that's just the way it was. And that it was a big thing to have your step clean and the yard clean. You had to have your yards and your step clean. They had standards, yeah.
Homing, nesting, building to be safe and secure.
Homing, nesting,
building to be safe and secure.
Homing, nesting,
filling our nests with feathers,
nesting. Homing, nesting,
and moss.
Filling our nest with feathers,
nesting,
homing, nesting,
and
moss.
Homing,
nesting,
homing,
nesting,
homing,
nesting,
homing,
nesting,
homing, nesting,
homing.
Blackhall Mill, we will never, never forget. This was our happiest years of all our lives. And 22 Conley Terrace, we all know that it's one of the most important places we could ever have been in, because we were all so happy and well brought up.
Homing, nesting, homing, nesting, homing.
10 in the family. We were all just all close. We used to sleep head to tail. And Jenny, she was hilarious, that sister. She used to have her toes. She was always wanting her toes scratched.
Me.
And she would give you sixpence if you scratched your toes. So we all agreed to scratching our toes, but she never gave us a sixpence.
Our natural medium is the air. Rise up and fly. Our natural medium is the air. Rise up and fly.
Blackhall Middle School was lovely. There was an infant school and a junior school, and you were separated until you went to the junior school. There was a school garden where the people who weren't academic were taught to grow things. There was woodwork, there was metalwork. There was a headmaster who ruled with a rod of iron, but he was fair, Mr. Ross.
Well, Mr. Ross was a headmaster. Mr. Thorpe was a teacher. Mrs. Altringham were my teachers. They were fair but very strict. You're talking at the time where you got the key in and you got lines and things like that, you know. Everybody was frightened of Mr. Thorpe because he was next army, you know. I think he'd been a sergeant major or something the way he went on. He was very, very strict. He was a cricket umpire as well. I remember when I left school, I was about 19, I was playing cricket. At Benfield's side, actually, and he was the umpire, and I didn't think he'd remember us, you know, and somebody bowled us, and I was going to be out LBW, and I says to Mr. Ross, I says, do you remember you from school? He says, yeah, I remember. He says, but you're still out.
The cookery teacher, to this day, I can still do a paper that she used to turn around the basins when you were in the cookery class. The maths teacher was, one of them wasn't very nice, but one of them was lovely. We still know his daughters to this day, lovely people.
There was a teacher called, well, I think we should call him Tot Smith. I think his name would possibly be Thomas or Thomas. And just before I got into his class, he was in class four. Now, class four, obviously, another three classes higher than that. But only the best ones moved on. And the poorer ones, or dunces, if you want to call them, stayed in class four until they were good enough and they moved on. So he was used to dealing with not the brightest people in the school. But Todd Smith, he started making these little cardboard things, which was like a forerunner of computers, really. We used to help him to make them. It would be a series of numbers, and we'd use like empty Smarty tubes, and you could line up a four and a four, and then the answer would come 8. Or if if it was multiplied, obviously the answer would come up for that. And we used to spend a lot of time in class helping him to make these, and it was quite brilliant of him in them days.
I remember the apples. It's a strange one to say, but they used to have apples in the orchard in the headmaster's garden, and used to sell them at dinner time. It was an old halfpenny for a small one and a penny for a large apple, and they were the sweetest, beautiful, most apples you've tasted in your life. They were absolutely lovely, you know. I got caught once. We used to climb over the school wall, which was about so high, on a dark night, and climb the tree. And he come out one night, and everybody run away, but I was stuck up the tree. And he says, you can come down now, I'll sit here forever till you come down. I says, oh God, I had to come down. And he actually let us off. He gave us an apple, just set us away. He's that sort of bloke, you know. He was an amateur filmmaker. He loved making films. He used to do films in the wood up by High Burn and that. And he done the one called Robin Hood with the school kids and that, you know.
But I got a Blackhall Mill school isn't there now, like. No. I've never been down that area for a long, long time.
No, it's gone now.
Our natural medium is the air. Rise up and fly. Our natural medium is the air.
The only thing that's left of the school now is the headmaster's house, and it's just past that tree there. The headmaster's house is still there, but the school's long gone. It's now a housing estate, as you can see, you know. And it was a happy times. I was 8, I was 11, then I went to chapel after that.
Zumba day, Zumba day. Once upon a
Now, our parents lived in Blackhall Mill. I lived in Milkwell Burn, which was just over the river. And when I used to take Robert down to Grandma's, we used to always go to Mrs. Russell's and get his sweets. And it was very old-fashioned inside and had all little old-fashioned wooden counters, nothing like the modern-day shops. It was really what I would call oldie world. It was really lovely.
I do remember the ginger creams and the arrowroot, which was really just like chewing on a twig, but it's what you did at the time. And they used to have something called monkey nuts, which they were like a dried up, I don't know quite what they were, but they were little brown, round things, you know. And those were great as well. But I mean, all the Edinburgh rock and, yeah, it's all this, all designed to rot your teeth.
And then there was a butcher shop. And I mean, the butchers then had its own killing shop, which, well, they would just fetch a beast in, take him in, and just do whatever they had to do then. And then they would strip it down and do it. It was all just done in the back shop. So you couldn't say it wasn't fresh meat that you got, because it really was, like, you know.
Behind this camera is a shop that was originally called Jimmy Bilney's. He had a brother at the Green at Chopwell who had a shop as well, and his sister was the postmistress around the corner from here.
My mum used to go in on a Tuesday, take me down, I was like this type of thing. And he used to have the biscuits along the front in like boxes with a clear top, and he used to always get a biscuit out the front of there, like he used to give you one.
It was a general dealer's and used to have groceries of all kinds. And on the other side, it was drapery, like towels, tea towels, paint.
Anything you wanted, he more or less had in that shop. And like I say, if he didn't have it in, he would get it for you the next day. There was no problem.
Next door, there was a hairdresser's, there was a cobbler's, and then there was the pub.
Well, behind us here, we've got the Riverview Apartments, which in our younger days was the Ship Inn. Really busy pub in those days, lots of activities going on, leak shows, darts teams.
Country and Western nights.
Country and Western nights, yeah, on a Friday night. We used to congregate in one side of the building, which had a jukebox. A lot of young people came.
It was the in place, wasn't
the
it?
The in place, yeah.
Blackhall Mill.
And as things progressed, the landlady and landlord at that time let us take over the back room, and she allowed some of the lads to paint it out black. The whole room was black. We had disco balls, so we used to have discos in there.
Yes.
It was really busy pub, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was very busy.
And then further up, there was a little... it wasn't General Dealer's, it was Mr. Wallace's, and it was like a little, he had like a little electrical shop and like a sweetie shop in all in combined, and the kids all used to go in and buy the sweets there, and if everybody wanted anything fixed electrical, Mr. Wallace used to fix it. And next door to him was the butcher's, so there was plenty of activity in this little street alone in Blackhall Mill.
Well, the main building was the Palace Cinema. That was the top of Armandside Terrace. Mm-hmm. I think it's a workman's club now, I think that.
Yeah.
Right. But over the road from there was the post office. Bessie Clegg had that. She played the organ at Blackhall Mill Chapel. And next to her was Figgy's shop. Now that was Figgy Iolini, ice cream man. And next to him was Weymouth, a general dealer. Then next to that was the Blackhall Mill branch of Blade and Store. Then next to that was Attles. It was a wooden, sold vegetables and that. It was a lady had it.
There was Olive Ackle. There was Ackle's shop on the corner, a wooden hut on the corner. She sold fruit and this on it. As I always say with Olive, you could pass there at 11 o'clock at night and she'd be at the door looking around and she'd say, I wonder if there's any more customers still around. As long as there was a sign that there might be a customer, she would stay open. And then when there was none, she would lock up and go home.
I mean, it's a lovely community now, don't get us wrong, but I think people were closer because they were more tied to not going away off with the cars and things, like, do you know what I mean? So you spent more time outside walking around in the village and actually getting your shopping from the shops, which then became a meeting place, because that's what you did. And the lads would go to the pits, then go to the pub, and then they would be walking back and forward together. So everybody knew everybody, like, and if you didn't know them, you knew which family they were from, or they were somebody else's cousin, or it was, you know, it was really closer that way, like.
But
I was a big film fan at Blackhall. The Palace was at Blackhall, the Palace Cinema. That is Monday and Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday, Friday and Saturday. And you're trying to be there for every change, you see. And you used to collect blackberries and sell them, or clear the yard with snow, or get an empty bin in your sledge and take the snow and tip it in the door. And
I remember the cheapest seats I remember was four pennies. That was in the very front wooden seats. A bit farther back, the cheapest sit, proper plush seats was ninepence and a shilling, I think, farther back. But I remember it was comical in them seats at the front. The kids would be coming down and the manager or his helper would be pushing them on, telling people, move along, move along, move along. And they were literally dropping off at the other end and running round and getting back on again, you know, because there was no partitions between them.
You had benches at the front, like tip up, and the bloke with a torch, quiet there, you know, they're shining the torch on you, you know. And that was a penny there, and the tip up seats were tuppence. And you'd look at the back and say, well, look who's in the tuppence, you know. Where are we getting the money from? Where empty pub bottles and, you know.
It's almost like I can hear him singing now.
And the old cowpoke went riding out one dark and windy day.
We used to watch all the serials, you know, the Gene Autry and the Roy Rogers and all of them serials.
And eventually, films on Sunday was allowed. And the first film on a Sunday was Captain Caution. And Roy and I often laugh about it. It was an actor called Victor Mature, Captain Caution.
On a Saturday, it was the Penny Scrush. That's when the serials were on. The Mystery Riders and Buster Crabbe was the Tars. You know, you would see Buster Crabbe. He would be chased and dive off this veranda into a crocodile infested river. Continued next week. You couldn't get there next week quick enough. And he did a double somersault and he landed over the river, you know.
The games that we played were sometimes influenced by the films. Because if you saw the film Zorro, which was a sword fencing film, we used to go into the wood and cut ourselves lengths of. And Hazel it was, to make a sword that we used to be. If it was to do with archery, we used to make bows.
We used to go to the cinema every week. I mean, we didn't have television in the early days. And I remember going one night with my dad, about 1956, I would think it was. And while we were in the cinema, the river flooded. This bankside that we're standing on now wasn't here then. They built this up later on to protect this area from flooding. And he had to carry me home on his shoulders because the water was so deep along to Fife Terrace.
Mum and Dad used to go to the first house pictures. They would say, now, you all look after each other. And, I mean, it was only you came out the back door of Connie Terrace and walked to the club 5 minutes. And the cinema was the Saturday first house, and they were back after about 2 hours, and we all had to behave in them 2 hours. But they went every Saturday, and that was their treat.
And every month, they had a variety concert.
Right. Like
John Sudders and his brother, they were two footballers. They were Hawaiian serenaders. But it was a good do, like. It was called the Gaff, the cinematograph. I got the Gaff the Neat. Well, that's how I spoke when I lived down there. But when you move up here, you had to speak a bit more refined. And that's why I didn't talk like that now, but I can mind.
And Blackhall Mill Club was like the place, like, apart from the lads that like to have a drink in the pubs, because a lot of the miners used to go into the pub sort of thing, and then they would go over to the club later, because the women liked to go to the club because they used to have a dance on a Tuesday night. I called it the Coffee Continental. I don't know why, but that was just what we knew as kids, like, you know. And they would do like the Bradford Bourne and them sort of dances. And it was, they really, really enjoyed it, but it was the only release they had from being at work for the full week.
There was a little area in the pub called the Snug, and there was a lady called my very good friend Janet Black. Her mother was always known in the village as Nana Black, and Nana used to love to have a drink, and she used to walk along from Connolly Terrace, second house down on Connolly Terrace. She would walk along the pub, sit in the Snug, and because the men that had to go past the Snug to get to the bar, she would then say, they would say, "Hello, Nana." And Nana always said, "Mine's a half." So she never bought a drink, but everybody loved her.
Well, I think we were born in a wonderful time. It was when it was the old-fashioned world, and that's what we love. I mean, I love the modern world as well, but that was when we were all young. We used to have many friends. There was always a house filled out place, wasn't there, Lydia?
Oh, yes.
My mum had everybody come for the Sunday teas on a Sunday, all our friends. Mum always let everybody come to the house, so she knew where we were, as well as the other children. It was a happy time.